Bagchi, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and students, a very warm welcome from both Aspen Institute India and iLead. Thank you for coming and being with us this evening. What promises to be a very interesting session indeed. You know, what makes a session even more engaging is when we have young people asking a lot of provocative questions. And I think that's probably what we're going to get a little bit of today. And I'm glad we have a really large a bunch of students, and we are hoping you're going to ask some really interesting questions. And I'm sure the chair and the speaker are going to do their best, because they are experts in the subject, to answer them. So yes, please feel free to ask questions during the interactive session, and make it truly interactive and engaging. And iLead students absolutely have done a marvelous job and kind of risen to the occasion and organized this evening. So we're really grateful to them. And Aspen India endeavors to provide forums such as this for dialogue and discussion on topical issues. And we're delighted to partner with iLead on this session on understanding China. So thank you, Mr. Chopra, Pragya, and your team for that. So with, this evening is about the iLead students kind of leading the way, and they're going to introduce the speakers and take you through the evening. So before I hand it over to Benjamin, I have to add that I'm really pleased and proud that Indrani, who not only in her role at the Times of India, but is also an Aspen India Leadership Fellow. So we're really delighted that she could come for a fleeting visit down to Kolkata, especially for this event. So thank you for that. And Professor Surendra Munshi is, of course, such a known face in Kolkata that he needs a little introduction, but he's going to get one anyway from the iLead students. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Benjamin to take it forward. Thank you.
A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of iLead and Aspen, we are pleased to announce the first of its kind, an interactive session on understanding China by two eminent personalities, Mrs. Indrani Bagchi and Professor Surendra Munshi, in the fields of media and academia, respectively. We are indeed very happy and privileged to have both of you this evening. iLead is an upcoming media and management institute offering full-time programs in BSc and MSc in Media and Journalism and BBA and MBA in Business Management. We offer a host of professional courses like Real Estate Management, Photography, Advertising, PR and Event Management, Digital Marketing, Digital Filmmaking, and many more. Our library has an enviable collection of books as well as audiovisual resources. Our mainstay is our faculty, comprising an interesting cross-section of academia and industry professionals using the latest methodology in teaching. iLead and Aspen Institute India are privileged to have some of the most prominent dignitaries this evening. Aspen India is a think tank that promotes value-based leadership, open dialogues, and cross-sector outreach by engaging the civil society, business, NGOs, governments, and other stakeholders on issues related to India's development. I would now like to welcome today's eminent personalities and the speaker of the day, Mrs. Indrani Bagchi, diplomatic editor, Times of India, and Professor Surendra Munshi, retired professor of sociology from IIM Calcutta and fellow of Bertelsmann Stiftung, who will be moderating today's event. With a background in English honors, Mrs. Indrani Bagchi had been the fellow Reuters Fellows in Oxford University in 1996. In 2010, she was awarded the Chang Ning Tien Fellowship by Asian Foundation to study U.S.-China relations in Brookings University, Washington, D.C. She basically covers daily news on foreign affairs in the Foreign Office, as well as interpret and analyze global trends with an Indian perspective. She started her career in journalism from the Statesman, Economic Times, and finally in Times of India in 2004. She is the fellow of the third generation class of Aspen India Leadership Initiative. May I now request Mrs. Indrani Bagchi to please come on the dais. I would now like to introduce Professor Surendra Munshi. Professor Munshi, the retired professor of sociology and currently the fellow of Bertelsmann Stiftung, a leading European think tank. He has talked and researched in India and abroad. He was the academic head of an international project on good governance that was supported by the European Commission. He served as the member of the Council of Global Thought Leaders for a project on globalization, corporate leadership, and inclusive growth, a project of the EVN Group at the International Institute for Management Development in Lausanne. Some of his publications in Asian journals of social science are noteworthy. May now request Professor Surendra Munshi to please come on the dais. May I now request both our eminent personalities to proceed with the discussion.
Thank you indeed for this introduction, and Indrani, good to be sitting next to you and moderating this session. And this is our, I think, also yours first visit to this campus, and we are very happy to be here. And we are also very happy to see bright students who are going to, I will join you in inviting all of you to be asking questions and raising the level of discussion to an engaging level. And a very brief comment before I invite you to speak. When I was asked to moderate this session, I couldn't say no for the simple reason that it's very difficult to say no to you. But we all know that. But apart from that, I was attracted to the fact that we are going to talk about China. Because for an Indian, for an Asian, and for someone concerned with the world, China, as we will hear from our speaker, China is indeed something, a country that we should engage with. But more than that, I must say I was attracted to the title, Understanding. We in this country have a habit of coming up with prescriptions more than attempting to make a serious effort at understanding. So when I saw that someone eminently competent to talk about this topic had chosen to speak of understanding China, I thought to myself, this would be nice to come and participate in this discussion. So basically, I would like to suggest, along with the speaker, we should be trying to understand before we come to policy recommendations for ourselves or for others. Understanding China. China is a very complex country in a complex world order. So to understand China is what we, I think, should be doing. And thanks, really, for giving us a lead with your title itself in that direction. And you have raised important issues about, you know, in which way China is moving, what is its impact on the world order, what's its impact, of course, on India. And I think these are the issues which are of concern to all of us. But as far as I'm concerned, I see, you know, China in the context of the following. China in itself, a complex country, and if you take the dimensions of China in terms of its geographical spread, in terms of its population, in terms of its economy, in terms of its rate of growth, you take in terms of its standing army, if you take in terms of its nuclear capabilities that are getting built up, in terms of whatever you see on Calcutta streets, more or less everything made in China, you name it, China is a major presence. And we need to understand China in itself. When I say China in itself, forget Asia, forget the world, we need to understand what's happening to China. And in that context, we need to understand that China is a complex country like India, in some ways more in some ways perhaps less, but certainly a very, very complex country. Behind a very massive economic performance that you see in China, there are very major complicated issues. To just name one, namely authoritarian governmental regime and free market, and how these two are going to work out in terms of future growth is something that we need to pay attention to. China in the context of Asia, and that's where we come. China in the context of Asia, you need to understand that Asia is an emerging region. Asia is becoming more and more important in the world order in more than one respect. And there, of course, China and India have a significant role to play. How China and India, as you have already suggested in your poster, how China and India are going to work out their relations is an important feature for us, for Asia, and for the world order. As far as China and the world order is concerned, I think it's a very significant thing that's happening. China is emerging as a superpower in many ways. Its muscle, if you like, or its economic strength is going to get reflected in many ways, and how China is going to work, play out this role is a very important issue. And I think on that will depend the nature of the world order in many ways that we are going to have. How China and India resolve their problems, how Asia emerges as a power, how China handles its internal problems, and what kind of world order that we have. The students here, I must tell you, you're living in very exciting times. Apart from technology that you see, which is changing every 5 years, and apart from that, the world is changing in very many significant ways compared to the generation of your parents. And in that big change, China and India are going to play more and more significant role. Whether that role is going to be for good or for bad depends on how these countries work out their destinies with each other and among themselves. With these few introductory words, which are basically nothing more than taking forward the brief description that you have given about your talk, it's my very great pleasure to invite you to speak. We have, I think, roughly 30 minutes, and after that, we would have an interactive session. So students, take out your pens and pencils and paper and take notes. I would be very happy to invite you, and I'm sure so will you, to this discussion. Thank you very much. And so, please.
Thank you, Professor Bagchi. Thank you, Mr. Chopra. And thank you, Aspen, for inviting me. I hope I can do justice to the expectation. It's always difficult to manage all this expectation. But I'd like to focus on how India and China look at each other. The difficulties, the features of the relationship, what is it that makes us look at China and sort of be completely confounded? And why is it that when the Chinese look at us, they are even more confounded? Because it's not just India that is unsure of how to deal with China. In many ways, China too is unsure of how to deal with India. And given what I do for a living, I will look at this from the point of view of foreign policy, security, and strategic affairs. So, and please feel free to ask lots of questions. I'm happier answering questions. But I'll just start by saying that India and China are neither friends nor rivals, but both countries with enormous populations, ancient civilizations, and ambitions to match. They're stepping out into the world, their ambitions and their geopolitical spaces are increasingly coming up against each other. Generally speaking, China's natural sphere of influence is to its east, in the Pacific Ocean. India has been much more... Is it easier now?
It's much better. Much better.
Is this better? Can you hear? Yeah? Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. China's national sphere of influence is to its east, towards the Pacific Ocean, towards the East China Sea. India's always been more westward looking. much more, its natural sphere of influence is much more towards the Indian Ocean and westward, as well as its immediate neighborhood. But India is stepping out beyond its neighborhood, and China is getting ready to become a superpower. So the Himalayas are no longer a barrier between us. The competition and confrontation between these two countries are natural. That it does not lead to anything more than that is where the two countries, the two governments, the two people come in. And that is why it's much more important for us to understand how this giant neighbor to our north is shaping up, what is its future, how does it deal with us, and how do we deal with China. For that, I'd like to run you through a couple of features that I have observed in the bilateral relationship between India and China. The Chinese economy, as you know, is about four times the size of the Indian economy. And if you travel to China, you would understand why the Chinese believe India is still too poor and too chaotic for it to be a credible rival. And it's a sobering thought, because in India, we are always, it's now almost a matter of habit that we compare ourselves to China all the time. But it's important to realize this, that at about a 6 trillion economy, it's much further ahead. But just the fact that we are growing, and we are growing beyond a $1.62 trillion economy to hopefully a $2.5 trillion economy, there lies the seeds of a future rivalry between these two powers. The interesting thing about the India-China relationship is the virtual absence of emotion, which makes this very different from, say, the India-Pakistan relationship, which is all about emotion. Whatever the dissonance that you observe between India and China, it's all about geopolitics. It's about economics or strategic futures. But it's not people looking at each other and saying, oh my God, you sent 5 terrorists here yesterday. And this is, my grandfather lived in that lane, in that city. There is none of that personal underbelly that we find between India and Pakistan. Nevertheless, on the India side, we have haunting memories of 1962, of the 1962 war, of Sella Bomdela. You will see a lot of that, and that memory continues to affect a lot of strategic thinking about China in India. On their side, every time they see the Dalai Lama in India, they are convinced that India has a lock on China's biggest separatist movement. And I'll tell you, in 2008, just before the Olympics, when there were Tibetans were protesting in different parts of the world, there was a huge Tibetan protest in front of the Chinese embassy in Delhi, which was completely unprecedented and also without warning, shall we say, because we were at the Chinese embassy that day when the Chinese ambassador was telling us how wonderful it was that the Indian government had controlled all these Tibetan agitation, etc. And within minutes, there was a protest outside the embassy. It took the Indians by surprise, but you know, Indians are used to protests, so you deal with the protests the way Indians deal with protests. But the Chinese couldn't. In Beijing, they were so angry, they called the Indian ambassador out to the foreign ministry at 2 a.m. To deliver a protest, which doesn't really happen. You know, you don't really call the ambassador at 2 a.m. in the morning. But that is how it worked out. To Indians, they look at the Chinese dealing with Tibetan protests and they say, but you know, these are protests. They happen. In India, protests happen. That's what we do. That's not what they do. And we need to be a little more sensitive to the fact that they don't do it that way. Of course, they need to be sensitive to the fact that we don't do it any other way. In fact, if you read any sort of commentary on Chinese social unrest, they bemoan the fact that they now have about 100,000 mass, what they call mass social unrest in China per year. It's something sociologists, economists, policymakers in China worry about every day, because they base social stability, the stability of the Communist Party, the longevity of the Communist Party is based on the kind of social stability that they have, and they find this social stability under threat with these mass protests. So when a Chinese sociologist actually said this in Delhi once, and I remember the Indians on the other side saying, 100,000, and what constitutes a mass social unrest? It's a collection of 30,000 people. Is a minimum of 30,000 people gathering to protest against anything? And I remember the Indians looking very puzzled. They said, but 30,000 people show up at our weddings. So the degree of difference of how we approach unrest or how we deal with unrest defines the difference between the two nations. In India, you can have the social unrest, people burning buses, etc. The next day it becomes a tiny little piece in the newspaper. We've forgotten, we've moved on to the next protest. They don't do it that way. So, but to go on to the features of the relationship that make it difficult for us to understand each other, there are very weak government ties between the two countries, unlike, say, between India and the US or India and the UK. The fact is that there is a language issue. It is difficult traditionally been difficult for Indians and Chinese governments to deal with each other, because they're two very, very different political systems. That is changing. That is changing very, very quickly, because in around 2009, the Indians certainly decided that the direction India-China relations were going, we would be ending up with a rivalry very soon if something was not done about it. So the engagement, official engagement, has increased enormously, but it's still very weak. Civil society does not interact with each other, and that leads to a great degree of misperceptions. We don't have students coming by or students going from here. We don't have the kind of tourism that you see, say, for instance, in the US. I mean, one of the things that I always say, you know, 45, 50 years during the Cold War, when India was so closely aligned to Russia, every Indian was sending their child to America to study. And that built the kind of sort of the ballast of the relationship. Is a people-to-people relationship. We don't have that with China, and that needs to change. It can't change overnight, obviously, because their system's very different. But Chinese are moving out. The Chinese are traveling. They're becoming tourists as well, almost as big tourists as we are. So this is something that we need to change, and this is something that can only happen at the civil society level. This cannot happen at the government level. We have a very loud, free, and a very powerful media. We are intrusive. We bring down governments. We go to great lengths to preserve our independence. And in many ways, we would probably be responsible for talking up the India-China rivalry. And we have talked it up in the last 4 years. It has been reciprocated, I will say, in equal measure in China, but in a different way. In India, you will see, as anybody who watches Times Now would know, that if you believed everything Times Now said, we would be at war with the Chinese every second day of the week, just as we would be at war with the Pakistanis every third day. But that is actually very difficult for the Chinese to deal with. The kind of loud, open debates about India-China, about bilateral relationships, about ourselves, of course, that we see on Indian media is difficult for them to deal with. They don't deal with it that way. So, but why the why media? It is what I call traditional media, and here I mean print and television. Traditional media is controlled. It's not so with the net, and Chinese have taken to the net, to the internet, in a way Indians have not. And you see the kind of microblogs, the blogs, the Weibo, that's their voice. And increasingly, that voice is being heard, that voice is shaping policy, that voice is getting the governments, local governments, to, as we saw this week, to stop copper factories in Xifang. That is, that's getting people together on the streets. That, so it is also a very nationalistic, very aggressive voice that you see coming out of these microblogs, the netizens of China. Their approach to India is very different. Their approach to India, in fact, a friend of mine did a survey of sort of cutting across all kinds of blogs and Weibos in China, and he's a Chinese, and he did a very interesting survey a couple of years ago where he said that there are liberal blogs and there are hardline blogs, but across them, India has a very negative response in China. That's not so, say, for the U.S. because there are hardline blogs that are very anti-U.S. There are liberal blogs that do talk about the other side of the story. Not so with India. He said it was quite interesting how uniform the negative approach to India was. And again, I put it down to their lack of understanding, not just on our side, but also a lack of understanding on the other side. How we deal with this, and this is actually going to become a bigger problem between India and China going forward, because in India you get what you see virtually, because your television, your newspapers, etc., are there. It's all in the private sector. But in China, of course, a lot of it is controlled, a lot of it is state sponsored, a lot of it is state led. So you're always confused. You don't know whether that Global Times editorial that came out last week trashing India did it really come from the mind of the author, or was that sponsored, or did the idea come from the Communist Party? So we tend to treat it as coming from the Communist Party. That may be dangerous going forward, because Chinese society too is getting nuanced. It is opening up, it is becoming a lot less monolithic than what we think about it today. So that's something that we really need to address, I think. There is widespread ignorance about each other's systems. And we treat the Chinese as one voice, and that whichever voice that we read, that we presume to be the voice of the Chinese Communist Party. On their side, the Chinese believe that all this media coverage about India-China is all done by the central government. And we do have, in fact, the last 3 years, they've been getting across lots of visitors, journalists from China. A lot of them show up at our office. I remember a couple of them asking us, when you criticize the government, do they scold you? So, and you could see our journalists seem scold us. We are the Times of India. we scold them. it is difficult for them to understand. But the Chinese have been a lot, they've poured in journalists into India. There are more Chinese journalists covering India in India today than there are Indian journalists in China, and they complain about that all the time. But you know, the systems are different. Our journalists, our media is all in the private sector. It's not everybody that can afford a correspondent in Beijing. To go back to China itself, China's having it's got its own domestic problems. It's got its, and we don't understand those domestic problems. And earlier this year, the Chinese Bo Xilai, the Chinese leader Bo Xilai had to resign, it was an event of humongous proportions in China when his police chief Wang Lijun went to sought refuge at the U.S. consulate. It was huge, and I couldn't find an editor in the Indian media who actually thought that to be an important story enough to be put on page one. We relegated it to the foreign pages. And this is something, if that had happened in Pakistan, we would have put it on page one. We would have put it on page one. Because we understand that. We understand what it means if Yusuf Gilani is tossed out by the Supreme Court. We don't understand what it means when Bo Xilai was sacked. We don't understand. We don't get the ramifications of that. And we won't, because obviously it's an opaque system. It's not just authoritarian. It's a fairly opaque system. There aren't people spilling their guts out on media as they are in India. So it's difficult to understand. But I think we need to make that effort. So what is it that China worries about? China worries about several things about India. One of the most important things it worries about is the India-US relationship. According to the Chinese, India would not be a worthy rival if it wasn't for the fact that it is growing so close to the US. The flip side of that worry is that in recent, I would say in the recent year and a half, at least the last couple of years, there is an understanding in China, or at least a sort of a slow realization in China, that you need to take these Indians a little more seriously, because if you anger them too much, they go sign up with the Americans, and then things would be really bad for us. Not always the case, but you know, frankly, anybody looking at history, that is China's own history. As in 1969, when China was having its own problems with the Soviet Union, China did what they accuse us of doing now, which is they went up and made friends with the U.S. But now the India-U.S. relationship is something the Chinese worry about quite a bit. So, I just run you through the last few years. Why? Because in my view, observing the relationship as it has played out over the last few years gives us a fairly good feel for the texture of the relationship. So I will start with the low. The low, in my opinion, started in September of 2008. This was in Vienna, at the where the nuclear suppliers group was voting on a waiver to India as a result of the India-US nuclear deal. We were all as good hacks sitting on the pavement outside the building, because the owners of the building, which is the Japanese embassy, would not let us inside. So we were all sitting outside, and for 3 days that's what we did. We sat outside, and it was actually a revelation watching the Chinese delegates walk out in a huff in the middle of the night. And it needed the US, because of course the president of China would not take a phone call from Manmohan Singh. So it needed Condoleezza Rice and it needed George Bush to step in the middle of the night to have the Chinese government call their negotiators back to the nuclear suppliers group to vote on a waiver on India. That was a moment, it was a sort of a standstill moment, because so far, no Indian sort of policymaker, nobody in the government, believed that the Chinese would actually stop them. at the end. For 3 years, as India and the US negotiated this deal, we were always told, yeah, the Chinese of course have problems with it, but they will come around. But they didn't. And the next thing you had everybody asking, the Chinese don't want us to do well. And that was, so 2 days after the vote in Vienna, the Chinese foreign minister was in Delhi. Very unusually, he agreed to do a press conference. They normally don't, they stay away from us. But he agreed to do a press conference. And after the first three questions, he said, that's it, I'm not answering anymore, because the first 10 questions were, why did you vote? Why didn't you want us to get the nuclear deal? And they didn't realize how big a deal that was for us. We didn't realize why they had stopped, why they were stopping us from getting the deal. So anyway, so that, in my view, was the beginning of the trough of the relationship. It worsened. In 2009, when the Prime Minister went to campaign in Arunachal Pradesh, the Chinese protested formally. That was unacceptable. That, if you ask any government in India, they will tell you that was the real low. They protested against the Prime Minister, then they protested against the Dalai Lama. We started out on an India-China bilateral territorial problem in public through 2009-2010, because for the rest of the year, the media was full of stories of Chinese intrusions across the line of actual control. How many of those intrusions actually happened? What is the real story of the intrusions? We talk about that later. If you ask a question, we talk about that later. But whenever you want me to stop, I'll stop.
No. Please go to.
And so that continued. That continued until 2010, when the Chinese actually stopped an Indian general from traveling to China because they gave him a stapled visa. So they moved the problem, they moved the bilateral issue to a completely different level, because then Kashmir became part of the India-China India-China problem, which was completely unacceptable. It needed a very otherwise very well-meaning UPA government to actually catch the Chinese and say, we will stop supporting the One China policy if you continue to do this. So you can imagine the depths to which the two countries had actually gone. But both stepped back for very, very many reasons, and we'll go into that as we talk about it later. And I think both stepped back because neither side wanted this to become, to get to a confrontation which would not be in anybody's interest. India certainly does not want to make the Chinese relationship a mirror image of its Pakistan relationship, for a whole lot of reasons, and I'm sure you would be able to figure out all of them. China, for its own part, I think came to the conclusion that there was no point in angering Indians beyond a point, because then the Indians can do random acts of madness, and I think they cannot deal with it. So one of the things that we did, and as a result of this 2009, was, you know, if you see the Northeast now, there are more fighter airplanes there, there are more fighter squadrons there. India's out there in the South China Sea prospecting for oil. We were out there welcoming the US and Russia into the East Asia Forum at the Bali Summit last year. I haven't seen so many of China's neighbors ganging up against China. Except for one, I think 17 countries sort of wrapped China on the knuckles for its policy. So everybody's relearning how to deal with China, and that is really the game for all of us. It has brought the U.S. back into Asia. It's brought the U.S. the pivot, the strategic pivot for the U.S. is back. U.S. is back in Asia, which puts an entirely different dimension China's growth, to India's growth, to Asia's growth. And you have seen China in the last couple of years, China's actually done itself a disservice by being an aggressive superpower in its neighborhood. The people who have, we have reaped the sort of political security dividend of China's behavior in its own neighborhood has actually been India. Quite by accident, really, because as neighbor after neighbor of China felt the brunt of Chinese hegemony or Chinese behavior, many of them turned to the U.S. It brought the U.S. back. Certainly, all of them turned to the U.S. Many of them turned to India. It has China's behavior has helped to change Japanese foreign policy. It has changed Australian foreign policy. I mean, remember, 3 years ago, there was a prime minister in Australia, Kevin Rudd, who spoke Mandarin. China-Australia relations died soon after that with Japan, and Japan wanted to be friends with China. I mean, they too had a new government who were far more liberal towards China than the old. They too fell by the wayside. The Koreans are hedging against the Mongolians. The Mongolians are calling Indians, who of course cannot respond in the way we ought to, but the Mongolians would call the Dalai Lama. That is how it's unheard of. So the Filipinos, the Filipinos are almost ready to go to war with the Chinese over the Scarborough Shoal. So it's, in many ways, India's reaping a political and security dividend for Chinese behavior. The Chinese will learn, and Chinese will go back, and they will become much better neighbors. Hopefully so will we. But as we go forward, we will be rubbing up against each other. And I'm going to stop now because I'm hoping all of you will have lots of questions. We will be rubbing up against each other. But we haven't actually talked about the fact that it's not all bad news on the India-China front. On many, many issues like climate change in multilateral organizations like G20, etc., India and China are actually all on the same side. In fact, in 2009, when we were having our worst bilateral times between India and China, the India and China sort of ganged up together at the Copenhagen Climate Change Conference. And I remember lots of delegates from Europe saying, but we thought you had a problem. How is it that, we are learning to deal with each other, we are learning to be a lot more mature. The Chinese too are learning to be a lot more mature about it. And frankly, it is a much more mature relationship today than it has ever been. But there is the danger, there is always this danger that the border issue, the territorial issue, Dalai Lama, all of these have the potential to suddenly flare up and become something quite ugly. Let's leave that for the question and answer. Thank you so much.
He's actually with Brookings. He's
Brookings in Washington. He is Chinese, and he spent 2 years. He's written a very interesting book about how Chinese opinions of other countries. Every country except India. So when I asked him, he said he had done a special study on India, which was sent to me. I'm happy to send it to you if you wish. And he covered it for 2 months. He surveyed Chinese blogs for 2 years and came across with a uniform, not, you know, it's not uniform, but the degree of difference between the good and the bad is less for India than it is for the US. For the US, you do have a lot of anti-opinions, but you do have there is a much more liberal approach to the US as well. That is not so regarding India.
Thanks a lot. I would like to open a broader discussion, and before I do that, just a few highlights. She has talked about India-US relation in the context of differences that India and China have with respect to how we handle protest. That's how she began. How our media behaves differently in these two countries. How, for instance, China in terms of its policy has been traditionally more east-looking, while we have been more west-looking. How, for instance, there is a lot of ignorance in both these countries about each other. And how, for instance, bilateral relations in India as well as China, issues like the Dalai Lama or border dispute or Arunachal Pradesh and so on, stakeholder visa, how these can be major issues or can have the potential of a good deal of harm. And how, for instance, fifthly, how Chinese hegemony can be a problem for not only India but for the other neighbors. And on a positive note, how, for instance, China and India are learning to behave in a more mature manner with each other. I think this is what you have highlighted. I would like to direct your attention to these points so that the discussion is focused on what she has said. And I think the critical issue underlying what she has said is basically how, for instance, India and China, from competition and cooperation, can slide into conflict and confrontation, and how it is vital for both India and China not to let conflict and confrontation become the dominant mode of relationship, and how we can gain by competition by all means. I don't think you're against competition, but certainly competition to promote cooperation. Now, you're all students of management here, you know that there cannot be any other mode of cooperation better than competition. Now, if with these comments, I would suggest we take three questions in a round. And first of all, watch the hands, right or left hand. Yeah, okay, fine. 1 minute, please. Other two hands, if you can see. Two and three. Fine. Please, sir. You.
I'm alone, and I'm not going to ask a provocative question. Am I allowed to get a little bit away from the political aspect of this discussion? It's not going to be a philosophical.
Please,
because after all, we've been talking about the political nuances of India-China relations and all these things. What I would like to ask is, with your understanding of China, you talked about their economic and their growth of their economy. It's a totalitarian state, yet their economy is growing. We do not have a totalitarian state, and we know where we are going. So therefore, what is it that makes the Chinese economy tick?
That could take an entirely, a complete session by itself.
Can you allow me one thing? Can I take two more questions,
yes,
and then you can answer? Thank you indeed. Now you please. Kindly announce your name if you like.
Hi, I'm Suhani Arora from the British Deputy High Commission. I have a couple of questions. You can answer just one if you like, or you have the time. The first is, I wanted to know what the impending leadership change at the Politburo level means for the sort of Indo-China relationship. I know it tends to be a bit of a black box, but I'd love to hear your insight on that. The second is, what can we learn from China in terms of our engagement with Southeast Asia and Asia? I mean, there are a few pitfalls that we should avoid. But what can we learn, and how can we sort of step and fill the vacuum?
One more question.
I saw one hand there.
Three questions.
One more question.
I'm A.C. Bose. I spent 40 years in the steel industry. Retired now. Last few years were dealing with WTO issues in Paris. And we had the Chinese delegation there also. And one I want to point out is that you mentioned the two countries does not engage. Actually, as far as civil society is concerned, if you're looking at trade issues, in fact, it is, I found quite surprising that there are companies in Calcutta, for example, who are moving their manufacturing facilities to China in order to take advantage of the local laws and the trade laws. There is also the issue of their foreign exchange rates, which is resulting in very cheap goods in very crucial sectors. For example, I believe that the lock industry of iLead, they have been very badly affected. They have almost had to shut down because what is coming from China is far cheaper. And this is not because of the efficiency of the Chinese economy. It is because of the exchange rates, how it is managed. So I wanted to get your comments on that.
Thank you. So please.
Right. As I said, how does the Chinese economy tick? There will be many better people than I to answer this. But I think China, A, started out with this, it's export and investment driven. And you've seen the investment that has fed the Chinese economy for the last 30 years. To put it really simply, I think, China creates the capacity, it creates a supply, invites investment, investment comes in, manufacturing happens, goes out to a different, it's export led, as you know. In India, it's very different because in India, investment only comes when you can see the demand. For instance, you did not have enough telephones. MTNL could not deliver. You were compelled to open up to private players. And then you saw the growth of the telecom industry. The same with civil aviation. Hopefully the same will be with infrastructure. The Chinese do it the other way. They create the infrastructure, they create capacity. And the Chinese, the scale is very, very different. The scale is very, very big. So you've seen how the Chinese have grown. I mean, when I think between 78 and 2009, I think world growth was something like 2.7%. China grew at a rate of 9.5%. From 2008 onwards, the world, everybody else has been floundering. This is probably its worst. So their model is very different. Our model is not bad. Still plays an important role in our society. And I think the more disengaged politics from economic growth, the better it will be for us. And we have seen, between 2003 and 2006, India really was on a roll because we really got that right. After 2008, we fell into a different sort of a group. To go back to what you asked, changes in, we know that there is Xi Jinping and there is Li Keqiang. We know that there are these two leaders who will be the next president and the premier. On the surface, they've been very good. We don't know what the 23 are in that group. For instance, that as the Shanghai, the Shenzhen group has probably lost the
politics will have to play itself out, and I don't think we have an answer on that. How it will affect India, you know, it probably affects America more than India. Really not part of, on top of their strategizing yet. By March next year. So I think you will find that they probably they have issues to worry about, the internal, they have their domestic economy issues to worry about, their issues to worry about. So I think they will be internally focused for some time. I don't see problems, unforeseen problems in the way of territorial conflict. Yes, if sort of the Dalai Lama, aspect of India-China relations. I don't think that will be pretty, because I don't think even the Chinese have an idea of what the refugees, that the Tibetan refugees in India, what kind of a political force they may become going forward. I would be skeptical about that area when that happens, and that will happen. We know that will happen. So that's an edge. But that has nothing to do with the leadership transition. Although some people would say that Hu Jintao has huge interests in Tibet because of his own past as head of the Tibet. So he may have been a lot more interested, a lot more engaged in the Tibet question in the last couple of years than perhaps Xi Jinping in the next couple of years. That's, what was the second question? Yeah, well, you know, the thing is, we are not, I think from at the outset, we are not like the Chinese in terms of that we are not an aggressive, we are not aggressive in terms of our foreign policy. Where we should learn from the Chinese is, one of the ways the Chinese sort of locked these states in is with the supply chain. We don't have that. We have to be able to create that alternative supply chain in these countries, and I don't think we are there yet, because that's not the way the Indian economy is built. We are a much more domestic consumption-driven economy. So that was one of the best ways the Chinese sort of locked these nations in.
China is going to go down very fast. If you notice yesterday, the Bank of China cut its rates within 10 minutes of the Bank
ECB.
Of
ECB.
Now, this is important. Yeah. They've cut bank rates twice a month. Yeah. That means they are worried about growth.
Absolutely.
Their Prime Minister said 7.5 for the growth of 4%. Now, for India, growth going down is a different factor. We are a democracy. We have safety valves. We have no safety valves. If this growth goes down, which it will, because the American market and the European market are not going to grow fast, then it will create a lot of social unrest. For example, Hong Kong. Do you know there were large numbers of Chinese in that protest?
Indeed.
Why? Because their farms were confiscated. This never happened before. They came to Hong Kong to do it. Same with the cement that you said. Fine. Now these protests are growing. What my question is that the new government that takes over, it will be a watershed for them. Then change the whole noise policy. Now the new fellow will have to make a change.
we need a moderate change, they want a control. But that type of control may not be possible now. What is your opinion?
One second, please. Can we take two more?
Sure.
Could you, please? Okay. Do you want to read it? Yeah, I'm Biju Abraham from IIM Calcutta. I mean, this goes back to the point that Professor Munshi made at the beginning about this contradiction between authoritarian government and a free market economy, in the sense that, you know, there are two different views on how this will play out. One view, of course, is that you cannot reconcile the two, and eventually you will have a big political explosion, denomin two, as it were. And the other view is that China will go the way of South Korea or Taiwan. You have a dictatorship, but eventually, as free markets develop, as the economy develops, you will gradually become a democracy with perhaps some kind of self-class control. I just wanted your view on how you see this playing out. I mean, are you going to see greater democracy happening because the government allows it, or are you eventually going to see confrontation?
Indrani, one more question, please. Yes, please.
I'm Indrani Bagchi. I just wanted to ask a question related to technology.
Can you put the microphone?
Yes. According to Joseph Needham of Cambridge University, China was the most technologically developed society till about 15th century. It slipped relation to the West, and now again it's gradually coming up in relation to intellectual property and technology, which we see in communications and computer technology, hardware side especially. What do you foresee? Like, India is nowhere on the technology side. India is more into IT services, where it's just a cost leverage which India has. So how do you see India and vis-a-vis China on the technology front?
Mr. Bhagat, I couldn't agree with you more on China and social unrest. If you've noticed, the Chinese, when I gave the figure of 100,000 in unrest incidents a year, you would also have noticed that in the last couple of years, the Chinese have actually been giving in to the protesters in Wuhan and Wuhan, early this year, when the people actually cleared out. They did a clear out, Chinese clear out, and in Xifang last week, where the government has given in. They've actually conceded. I think one of the things that you will probably see is they might create more such incidents as to show that yes, we can be reasonable, or yes, we can accommodate if you are reasonable. On the other hand, Hong Kong protests, I would see that a crackdown will happen in a quiet sort of way. Not too long from now, because you have seen a sort of signification of Hong Kong over the last 15 years, but you will probably see more, and I think you will see more of voices being curtailed, but that's the one side. But the new leadership is nowhere nearly as powerful as the years of Deng or even Jiang Zemin. They are nowhere near, they are much weaker. So the factionalism between the different groups that control the Politburo is much sharper. And you did see that playing out when the Boshila event happened. But I would say that factionalism may sharpen if economic growth goes down further. Because they do this delicate balancing act of keeping the factions in balance with the economic growth, so the provinces, the state or mayors, etc., get all this largesse to build all these bring in them. They put in their stimulus in different ways, which will be very difficult to come by as we go along. In fact, you would have seen the Chinese government's actually said it on record this year that they would not have another stimulus as they did in 2008-2009. So I agree with you that I think they are feeling the pinch much more than we realize, because obviously they're such an opaque system. They don't publicize a lot of their figures. So I think you will see a lot more social unrest. So the new leadership will be more absorbed dealing with social or internal issues, internal stability. Whether they will become more democratic, I don't know. They believe they're democratic anyway. They don't actually think that the democracy that we have is anything to aspire for. It's too chaotic for them. They can't. This kind of system is not for them. So, would it be democracy with Chinese characteristics, which is the party believes or shows that it is a lot more open to dissent, to protest? Would that constitute democracy? Who knows? I mean, you saw what they did to Chen Guangchen when the U.S. Secretary of State was in China. I mean, that was something that sort of hit them in the face. And you could see they fumbled, they floundered, they didn't know what to do. So I think you will see a lot more of this going forward. Kiju, what was your question?
Democracy versus
I see this question coming up a lot of the time. Does this mean that we will? I mean, is it the two systems sort of pitting against each other, and who will win? I'm not sure I have the answer to that.
No, I was not asking about that. Question was really about which way it would go. Would you see a confrontation either between two as well, or do you see them changing like South Korea?
I think they will change, frankly. I don't think they will do another China. The Chinese are learning on the job too. They're smart people. They're running this enormous economy, this huge country. And they're not fools. They can see what Tiananmen did. Much more mature. They can't afford to deal with it in any other way. If they did, they would fall apart because they don't have a safety valve. We've moaned and groaned about a 7%, 6.5% economic growth, but we continue. We're not setting parliament on fire. But they fear that the legitimacy of the Communist Party would be at stake. So I would be. So I think they would have built. Or at least I hope that they would have built systems to be safety valves in situations that may come about as a result of lower economics. On the question of technology.
Yeah. And maybe perhaps if you don't mind a shorter answer, because I would like to engage the students.
Yes.
I'm not going to take questions from white shirts, only black coats. All right? Only black coats, with the exception of you, because you raised your hand. No more questions from white shirts, only black coats, okay?
So, on technology, you know, frankly, I'm not competent to answer this. I think we are still two different systems in terms of hardware and software. I think we are much more than being just a low-cost back-office option anymore. India's, I think, moved fairly up on the R&D scale, on the innovation scale. The Chinese have moved even further. Where they are on IPR issues, I would refer you to many corporates who find that the Apple store, the fake Apple store in China, and there are many of them. If you go to a market called Silk Street in Beijing, it has a very interesting sign that says, "We respect intellectual property rights," and it's the best place to get fake knockoffs. So you know. But having said that, I think we are both on still two parallel trajectories where technology and innovation are concerned. Indian technology, I would say, is a lot more efficient because it is a lot more. It is in the private sector, so there are cost bottom line issues. Chinese innovations, Chinese technology, a lot less efficient. But having said that, the Chinese have just put a man on the moon. They've just sent a manned mission to space. We haven't yet. I think that's a debate we can continue to have for a long time to come. But to be honest with you, I'm not competent to answer that.
So now, one white shirt and the rest of the questions, please, only from the students. Now, please, you go ahead.
Yeah.
And I can see one hand there. And I need two or three more students. Please.
My name is Sukhrito Chondo. I've got one slightly weak question to ask. We have always been said that we Indians lack vision, which is why we lack vision. We lack vision. And that is why our policies flip-flop all over the time, depending on who's in power and who's the flavor of the month. My question is somewhat else. Do the Chinese really have a vision and do they stick to it? Or are we giving them superhuman powers, which they really do not have?
All right, thank you. Now, students, you.
Yes. Hello, sir. Hello, ma'am. I'm Joanna, pursuing my BSc at iLead. My question to you is, since you said like India and China are neither friends nor enemies, so do you foresee India and China joining
hands to become relationship with Japan? Well? Weeks back, we saw there was a trade relations between China and Japan in the renminbi. I wanted to know what kind of ramifications that could have, whether we would see an expansion of the power of the renminbi both in Asia or globally as well. And secondly, you spoke about how outward-oriented the Chinese economy really is. What I fail to understand is like how they continue to grow at such overwhelming rates, even when there are depressions, economic depressions across the world, whether it be in Europe or their main market in the United States. So how do they continue to grow economically when purchasing power across the world is diminishing?
One more hand.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Saisha Shivatva. I'm also from Lumadnya. I wanted to understand, ma'am, we do believe that politics and economics are two very closely related fields, and this couldn't be truer than in the case of China, because as far as political and military, as far as political involvement goes, it's always with economic investments as far as China goes. So my question was about the Southeast Asian region, where we see India and Afghanistan increasing relations in terms of strategic depth over Pakistan, and Pakistan's consequent looking to China. Ma'am, I wanted to ask you what exactly the depth or what exactly the length of the relations of Pakistan with China are in terms of, ma'am, we know that they're building nuclear reactors in Pakistan and we know that Pakistan considers them an all-weather friend, but I really don't know what the Chinese perspective is on this and, you know, how, to what degree this involvement or this interest in this entire Pakistan-India-Afghanistan dimension goes.
All right.
So let me start with Pakistan. The China-Pakistan relationship, of course, has become a thorn as far as India is concerned. China's been Pakistan's close ally for many, many years, and we know the history of all of that. In the last couple of years, that has increased as Pakistan-US relations have taken a dive. The Pakistanis believed that the Chinese would step in if and. Till date, that port has not taken a single commercial vehicle, vessel. And I think the reason is very obvious, because of there is a huge insurgency going on in Balochistan. We all know what is happening in the Northwest Frontier Province, in the Fata areas. I don't think the Chinese have been able to capitalize on that investment in Pakistan. That does not mean, however, that the Chinese would not continue to be Pakistan's ally, really close ally. And I would, however, be careful to say, to predict that the Chinese would invest themselves really deeply inside Pakistan going forward. If the Chinese understand Indians less, they understand the Pakistanis even less. They cannot understand what impels Pakistan to do what Pakistan does. And
they know the Pakistani.
Yes, they do. Earlier, you could not, as an Indian, you could not have a conversation with a Chinese strategist or a thinker on Pakistan. That was a closed subject. In the last couple of years, that is no longer a closed subject. And in sort of these track 1.5 dialogues that are now being set up between the Indians and the Chinese, I see more and more of a quiet concern on the side about where Pakistan is headed and what kind of an ally is Pakistan turning out to be. I mean, to be fair, the Chinese are probably doing the Pakistanis a favor when they decided to issue stable visas to Indians coming from Kashmir. That was the Chinese way of flavor going forward. In fact, it made a public statement saying, no, we are not. So I would be a little wary about predicting a China-Pakistan sort of closeness going forward. Yeah. About how do the Chinese grow? You know, you ask an economist. I'm only a hack. But I think so far it's been largely an export-driven, investment-led development strategy that has paid off brilliantly because the markets that were consuming them were the U.S., Europe, Southeast Asia, India, basically the whole world. How do they function in an era of low growth elsewhere in their markets? We still have to see. And you are seeing that. You are seeing a lower growth. You are seeing a difficulty of the Chinese system to be able to spur consumption. We are a consumption-led economy. They are not. The Chinese need to consume a lot more. They are not consuming enough. Their consumption to GDP ratio is pitiful. So that needs to go up. It's not going up. And there are a whole lot of reasons for that. I mean, I refer you to scholarly pieces that give you good reasons of why that is happening. But we take that later, after the event. As usual,
there's another question about the renminbi trade between Japan and China.
Yeah, look, the Chinese want to ramp up renminbi as an alternative currency to the dollar, and we know that. They've tried to do that in everywhere. You know, they do in trade with Iran in renminbi. They've tried to, in this organization called BRICS, they're all trying to set up a development bank, which would obviously have renminbi as its reserve currency, because guess who's the only country in BRICS who has all that money to make it a reserve currency. I'm not sure, but the Chinese currency is still a manipulated currency. It's not a free currency. They haven't yet put that currency up as a free currency. So let them do that. Then we'll see whether that currency can take on the dollar. But until then, it's just a parlor game, because it's a currency that, as you've heard, it's manipulated in a way that makes Chinese goods cheaper and elsewhere. So we will see. The Chinese are trying to push it up slowly, but I don't think that until the Chinese free their currency, I don't think this is a debate we can have right now. And I don't think, you know, world sentiment, you can see the sentiment just in the during the recession, during the slowdown in Europe. Where is the money going? The investment still going to America, it's still going to the dollar.
I would like to come in and say that, Indrani, after your presentation, the kind of clarification that she has offered to the questions that were raised were indeed very revealing and insightful, and I think the credit doesn't go to Indrani for that. I think the credit goes to the questions that were raised. So first of all, I would like to clap for the audience. And of course, for Indrani for giving us an exceptionally insightful and nuanced understanding about China. I think what struck me as I was listening and I was taking notes, what struck me was the manner in which a very nuanced and layered presentation was given through initial presentation as well as through handling questions. And as a sociologist, I can only say that future, whatever it will be, is not as definite for any country or for the world
it is nuanced, and there are always tendencies and counter-tendencies. And as a theoretical statement, one can say that we make our future, but not entirely with resources at our disposal. And I was very happy that Indrani struck a very, very happy balance between the likely scenario and also what could go wrong. And overall objective, and there I would share this sentiment as an Indian, as a world citizen, I would share entirely, and I'm sure all of you will, her overall sentiment that if countries like India and China should cooperate and not be on a destructive conflict confrontation path, but cooperate, and if that cooperation has competition, it's all right, but it should not be a negative relationship. Indrani has thrown up a few gems, if you like, of expression. The one that I particularly liked was India foreign policy terrorizing China through random acts of madness. I hope the mad people in Delhi are listening to her. And I guess if any amount of madness is increased as far as our foreign policy is concerned, it will come in as a very easy thing for people sitting in Delhi. But I think there is a serious message there. I think there is a serious message there, namely that a foreign policy from an Indian perspective, which is not sufficiently nuanced like the presentation today, which is not sufficiently insightful with respect to an objective, namely understanding a complex country like China, if it is not, it can be random and harmful. With these few words, let's once again applaud a very nice discussion. And the organizers, I much anticipate, will have a pleasant announcement for all of us now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your participation. May I now ask the chairman of this institute, Mr. Pradeep Chopra, to deliver the word of thanks.
Indrani Bagchi and Professor Shildar Munshi, it was really, really exciting and educative interaction between both of you and with the audience. What is my take from your discussion is that social engagement, which you said that is very little between India and China. And let me share one a very pleasant experience. I went to China a year back. Most of the furniture in this, including these chairs, have come from China. You know, this is one way of, you know, cooperation between the two countries, because they are very cost effective, very efficiently designed, and it is taking our level of work to another orbit. And not only this, you know, while I was in China, I had a lot of series of pleasant experiences. You know, my experience with a Chinese taxi driver who waited for almost an hour without cribbing because my friend has forgotten passport in the room, and he also misplaced his card to open the room, so it took him 1 hour. Think of a taxi driver waiting in Calcutta's road for 1 hour without tripping. It's like not possible. And recently we had some 6 Chinese students from University of Yunnan and University of Kunming. And I remember when they were leaving, most of them were crying, and most of our students were also crying. So you see, only 10 days of togetherness have created such a good bond between the students from China and the students from Calcutta. Recently, Ben had gone for internship with Gonja, and he had a lot of interesting and pleasant thing to talk about Chinese experience. So I feel that, you know, this social engagement is very, very important, as you rightly said. And we have a lot of reasons to have this kind of social engagement, because we had such a long history, we have religious ties, you know, Buddhism, and lot of things we learn from Chinese, and Chinese learn from us. We want, therefore, iLead, you know, focus on China. That's the reason, you know, we thought this was an apt subject to take. We teach here Mandarin to most of our students who are interested. And our focus is to understand, you know, like understanding China, understand how to engage with China in, on various fronts, not necessarily only on business, but also on, we had two Chinese scholars who came from the University of Beijing. I was amazed to see how fluent they were in Bengali. They could speak flawless Bengali, and one of them has translated the entire work of Rabindranath Tagore, and he says that the most popular author in China, foreign author, is Tagore. And 1 million copies of his translation is sold in China. And he said that Tagore wrote many poems in Chinese language, which the Indians don't know. So he has translated Tagore's writing in Chinese language into Bengali. A Chinese translating Tagore's poem in Chinese into Bengali, which he recited here. So these are all social engagement experiences. So I think that social engagement will make both countries understand each other much better, and we need to understand each other, because I think we have this complementary skills. They are good in manufacturing, we are good in service, they are good in hard work, physical labor, we are good in mental thinking and so on. So we can complement each other in many fronts, and as the gentleman rightly said, that the American and the European market is going into mess, we would provide them the biggest market in the world for their growth to continue at that high percentage. So it was a really, really good experience for both of you, engaging and, you know, exciting the all the audience here. I would like to convey my special thanks also to Aspen Institute, Rita Shri, because of you, you know, this whole thing was possible. So thank you so much. And the Consul General of United States and entire team, Dean Thompson. Thank you, sir, for finding time to be here. Ms. Suhani Arora, Political Economic Advisor, British Deputy High Commission. Thank you for being here. Captain Tarun Kumar Singha, the PRO from the Military Ministry of Defense. And Shamal Datta, he's left. Thank you so much for all of you for finding time and giving us this honor to be here. My sincere thanks also goes to the entire team of iLead who worked really hard to make this event possible. All the faculty members, the students, everybody. Thank you so much. And thank you, all the guests, all the participants here. Thank you for being here. Now I request you, all of you, to please join us for high tea on the second floor. Yeah? Yeah. Benjamin, okay.
May I now ask my fellow students, Urvi and Priyanka, to bring forward our token of appreciation for our guest. I would now request some of my fellow batchmates to come up here for a photo session with our guest.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, hello, your sister.